on behalf of Old Brady Baptist Church and myself, I just want to thank you very much for being here tonight. My name's Matt Otten. I was born and raised in a small town, Buffalo, Minnesota. I'm the baby of 8 children, and I'm 40 years old. I moved to Texas 20 years ago, so I'm an official Texan now because I've lived here longer than I did in Minnesota. My parents were married for 56 years until my dad passed away a couple years ago, so he's not able to be here tonight, but I know he's here in spirit. I am, however, blessed and honored to have my mom here, all the way from Minnesota. Hi, Mom. To share this time with us. And when I told her about tonight, she asked me when it was, and I told her it was September 13th. And she got a big smile on her face, and she said, "You do know that's your father's birthday, don't you?" And I had no idea, but I think it's cool how God planned it that way. So, yay, happy birthday, Dad. We love you. My oldest brother, Dwayne, is here tonight. Yay! If I pass out, fall down, he's taking over. So, and we have some very dear friends of the family, Brad and Jeannie Cornell. I'm married to my beautiful wife, Kristen. She's here tonight. And this past Saturday, we celebrated our 5th wedding anniversary. And they say that a man is not complete until he gets married, and then he's finished. So, I myself am happily finished. We have our 4-year-old daughter, Madison, here tonight. She's the joy of our life, at least most of the time. There have been a few times that we've tried to sell her on eBay just to prove that we're in charge and not her, but we always end up canceling before we call UPS and have her picked up. We just found out a month ago that God has blessed us with our 2nd child, baby O. And this part of tonight kind of came up last minute, but I thought it would be a great memory to share with our family in the years to come. So we're happy to announce tonight that we found out about 1 o'clock that we are expecting a little baby boy. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I'm the owner of Otten Brothers Taxidermy, and we're located just down the road in Burney, out 46 towards Pipe Creek. So raise your hand if you've ever heard of Otten Brothers Taxidermy before tonight. Okay, 4 people. So, I'm a little surprised that more of you didn't raise your hand because I've been told by quite a few people that I'm the best taxidermist in the world. Well, actually, 1 person, and my mom makes 2. So. But let's not take their word for it. I brought a few pictures of some of my most recent work, so you can judge for yourself. Yeah, here's one I did a while ago. We got Willie Miller. It's another one of my personal favorites. We also do fish. And we do birds as well. So, and it took a long time to get the hair just right on this guy. This next picture is of a letter that we took in a while back. And there was a small miscommunication. The client said that he wanted it sitting, but what I wrote down was he wanted it for sitting on. So this is what we ended up with. And he wasn't very happy. I don't think he's going to be back. Tonight I want to share some things about taxidermy with you, a little history, some proper care, and some frequently asked questions. I also want to share part of my testimony with you, and I hope to communicate some things that God put on my heart when I was in preparation for tonight. I am by no means a public speaker, but I'm in love with Jesus, and I feel that he has something to say through my testimony that someone in this room might need to hear before it's too late. So if you don't mind, we'll go ahead and pray real quick, and then I'll get started. Heavenly Father, I just thank you so much for Bull Verde Baptist Church. I thank you for their heart for you and all that they're doing in this community and the surrounding area. I just pray continued blessings over them and all they do and all in this church body. Holy Spirit, I just thank you so much for the strength and the courage that you've given me to be up here to share my heart with these folks tonight. I pray for safety and protection for everyone going home, and we pray all these things the precious blood of your son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
So what is taxidermy exactly? The word taxidermy can be broken down into 2 Greek terms, taxis, which is movement, and derma, which is skin. So you put them together and you get taxidermy, the movement or the manipulation of skin. Taxidermy first began in the 18th century, and seamstresses took small mammals and they stuffed them with old rags and cotton for display. And the anatomy was terrible, but it served the purpose of showing off the beauty of these animals. And this is also how the term stuffed animals got its start. The golden age of taxidermy was in the mid-1800s, when mounted animals became a popular part of interior design and decor. Even Queen Victoria had a large collection of mounted birds. In the early 20th century, taxidermy was taken forward under the leadership of artists such as Carl Egli and Coleman Jonas. These and other taxidermists wanted to focus on better anatomy instead of just stuffing animal skins with rags. They accomplished this, and it instantly became a hit with hunters as a way to preserve their trophies. Let's fast forward to today. I drink a lot of water, so. One of the questions I get asked a lot is, what happens after we leave our animal with you? And the first thing we do is we cape it off the head, and we put a tag on the hide and the antlers, so when these two get separated, we can get them back together. We freeze the hide, and from there the hide goes to the tannery. And they begin the tanning process, which is a series of chemical baths that transforms the skin into raw meat into a tanned product that's usable and suitable for taxidermy purposes. This process takes between 2 and 4 months, depending on their backlog when we drop it off with them. When I get the load of skins back from the tannery, I take measurements on them so we know what size form to order for your deer. With these measurements, along with any directions that we've discussed, we'll order a form accordingly. This is an example of just one. A lot of people ask what's inside, and this is just a styrofoam mold, and there's a lot of these to choose from, but this is just one that I brought so you can kind of see. The next step is the mounting process. And we'll take the skin, we thin down any areas that need more detail in the face and the ears. Then we have to cut out any scars that are on the front side or any bullet holes that may be in the cape. Next, we sew up all these holes. And we put Bondo inside the ears, and we reshape the anatomy of them. And the Bondo serves to hold the shape of the ear for years down the road. Next comes the detail work. We insert glass eyes into the form, and we use clay to shape the eyelids. Next, we'll add detail to the rest of the face. We use clay on other areas that need more detail. There's also hair patterns that exist in the cape, and when properly read, these patterns tell me where to add clay or cut out foam. Here's an example of a form that I did the clay work on, so you can kind of see how that works. After we get the clay on, then we apply glue to the entire form, and then we slide the skin over. And this is before the antlers are put on. Then we put the antlers on top, we attach them to screws and Bondo. And after we do that, then we start tucking all the skin, moving it around into place, and we tuck all the areas in the face. We reset the earbuds onto the form with clay, and then we manipulate them where we want them to go. After we do this, we just sew it up down the back, we pull it around, and then we staple the backside, and we cut off the excess. The next step is called what I call the babysitting time, and over the next 2 or 3 days, the mount's going to start to dry. And we just need to revisit it 15, 20 minutes a day just to make sure that there's no air pockets in the skin and make sure nothing's moved that we don't want moved. And we'll continue to groom the hair in the desired places. After that, it's not completely dry, so we set it aside. And the complete dry time takes between 1 to 3 weeks, depending on the humidity, the thickness of the skin and the hair of your specific animal. After this is complete, we brush out any excess glue, and we putty, there's a small crack, shrinkage crack around the eyes, and then we putty inside the nostrils. After we do this, we paint any areas that need painting, and then we gloss the nose to give it a wet look. And then we wipe oil on the antlers to clean that up a little bit. The last step that I do is unique to Otten Brothers Taxidermy, is I put a Bible verse on the back of every mount that leaves my shop. And I do this for a couple of reasons. The first one is it's a good way to get me into God's word on a regular basis. And secondly, I do it as a guarantee to my customers. The Bible says that no matter what you're doing, do it as though you're working unto the Lord. And even though you're not there when I'm working on your mount, you can rest assured that I'm doing the best of my God-given ability without cutting any corners. There are many different variables in the taxidermy process, but this kind of gives you an idea of the day-to-day in the shop. A lot of people ask me about proper care before they get it to me, and the two main ingredients for a good trophy is to keep them cold and dry. So when you've got the animal, you're going to wash them out, but there's no need, if there's any dirt or blood on the cape itself, there's no need to wash it off, because bacteria starts to develop around 42 or 45 degrees, and they love wet conditions. So if you're going to put it in an ice chest with ice, double bag it, and make sure it stays as dry as you can. If it gets a little wet, it's not the end of the world. Same thing with ducks. Just kind of lay the feathers down, their wings down to their side, put them in a plastic bag, and put them in the ice chest. And with fish, you don't need any kind of a bag. Those can just be dropped at the bottom of your cooler, fill it up with ice, and they'll keep that way for 2 or 3 days at least. Taxidermy is a great way to preserve a trophy that you've hunted, but it also tells a story. Sportsmen and women use taxidermy as a way to freeze frame a specific hunting adventure. It's not just the thrill of the kill, it's so much more. It's the drive to and from where you're going to be hunting, shared stories and memories while spending time out in God's country. You walk into any hunter's home that has trophies on their wall and ask them about a specific one, and I promise you they can tell you exactly the day that they harvested the animal. They can tell you the weather that day. They can tell you what color underwear they had on. And just, I don't make this stuff up. This is true stuff. And they'll be happy to share with you more information than you may care to know. I myself can't get enough of these stories. Here's a text message that I got a few weeks ago. FYI, Matt, those deer that you're working on are the last bucks that my family will be taking off of that ranch before it's sold. Sad stuff. My dad went to military school with the owner, and we've been going out there since I was in diapers. It's a one-of-a-kind place that meant a lot to me in my childhood. Even my wedding ring is made out of a piece of mesquite that we found on that ranch. You did a great job. I can't wait to get them hung up. I received this letter in the mail a while back. It's from a little 10-year-old boy. He said, Dear Mr. Otten, thank you for mounting my first buck. The European mount looks really good. I'm still thinking about the perfect place to hang it. And this year, if I shoot a bigger one, I'll definitely bring it to you. Thanks again. These are the reasons why I love my job so much. It really drives me nuts when I hear people talk about how mean and evil hunters are, and all we are is a bunch of bloodthirsty freaks. And that actually could apply to some of us, but we're not going to go there. I believe these people are just misinformed. So I'm quick to share with them Genesis 1, verse 26. God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." I don't know about you, but that sounds like a green light to kill and eat venison straight out of God's word. So, this we all know is without flaw. Another question I get asked a lot is, how did I start the business? I first became interested in taxidermy when I was about 13 or 14 years old. My brother Art, my second oldest brother, who lives in Minnesota, did taxidermy for a hobby. So being over at his house, I would see him working on different things, and the more I saw it, the more interested I became. And I finally asked him if I could mount something myself. So he pulled out a roadkill squirrel out of the freezer, and I really enjoyed working on that. And over the next couple of years, I mounted a few other things with him. When I turned 16, I harvested my first whitetail buck, and I was fortunate enough to get him with my bow. And he let me mount that one all by myself. At this point, I was hooked. I began thinking how cool it would be to have my own taxidermy business, but I really didn't think it was possible because the taxidermy really didn't seem like work to me. So fast forward 5 years, I moved to Texas and I started working as a ranch hand on a ranch that my brother Dwayne is the general manager of. I worked full time for him and I continued taxidermy on the side. It was still on my mind how cool it would be to start my own business, but I had a problem. And that problem was, there was a demon in my life that was holding me back, and that demon was alcohol. I was a trained professional alcoholic. The more I drank, the more I wanted to drink, and I was good at it. I couldn't have just a few beers after work. It was all or nothing for me. So I would live for Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and I would drink as much as I possibly could, and I would spend all the money that I made during that week. And I continued this cycle for the next 4 or 5 years. I eventually left the ranch, and I got my first job working at a taxidermy shop in the Burney area. Eventually, taxidermy brought me to San Antonio, and it was there that I met my wife, Kristen, and a few years later, we started dating. But the alcohol still had a stronghold on me, and I was continuing to drink more and more. And it got to the point that beer wasn't doing it for me, so I switched to hard liquor. And I was drinking a big bottle of whiskey every other night. And occasionally I would mix it up with Red Bull and vodka. And my new routine was to drink for 2 days. I would take a day off, and then I would drink for 2 days again. So I continued to do this until I got tired of having to go to sleep. And it was then that I met another demon. It was a prescription drug that would keep me awake for a week straight without sleep, which was perfect for me because it just meant that I could drink more without having to stop. So needless to say, I was on a fast downward spiral with no end in sight. Then one day a friend of mine noticed a lump on my neck and asked me what it was. And I had seen it there for several years, but I'm the kind of guy that if it doesn't hurt, it doesn't need fixing. That's not a good idea either, by the way. So she persisted and told me that I really needed to get it checked out. It was probably nothing, but it could be something more serious. So I finally made an appointment, and I went to the doctor, and after the biopsy was done, they determined that it was nodular lymphocyte predominant Hodgkin's lymphoma, or cancer for short. So here I was, 35-year-old, fairly healthy guy, being diagnosed with a deadly form of cancer. I pretty much thought my life was over. They told me that the good news was if you catch it early, it's treatable, but if you let it go too long, it's almost always fatal. They asked me how long I'd known it was there. When I told them it was 3 years, the doctor turned white as a sheet, because he was pretty sure he was looking at a dead man walking. The next step was to remove the mask so they could examine it further. And it turns out the cancer that I have is a very rare type that only 5% of cancer victims in the world have. The key to determining how long I would live was to find out how far it had spread through my body. They scheduled what's called the PET scan, where they have you drink this radioactive fluid and it excites the cancer cells in your body. And in doing so, it can determine how far it has spread. In the meantime, I was praying that it had not spread very far, and I was also asking friends and family to pray the same. I called a friend of mine, Roger, and I told him the story, and I asked him to please pray for me. And he said he would gladly do that, but cancer is not of God, and that I ought not put him in such a small box. He said that God is a great and mighty healer, and I want to pray over you, and I want you to pray with me for complete and total restoration of your body. I reluctantly agreed because I felt I had nothing else to lose at this point. You see, I was living a lie that, so none of this made any sense to me. Because I thought this was God's way of punishing me for all the years that I lived for myself, drinking, doing drugs, running around. I even stole from my own family. My whole life was sin after sin after sin. And isn't it funny how when things are going great, we love to give ourselves a pat on the back and an attaboy for all the good things that happened because we did it. But when something goes wrong, we automatically blame God. That's not fair at all. So if you squeeze an orange into a cup, what do you get?
Orange juice.
Anybody? Orange juice. Good. If you squeeze an apple into a cup, what do you get?
Apple juice.
Apple juice. So if you squeezed an orange into a cup and you drank it and it tasted like apple juice, that would be pretty weird, wouldn't it? So why isn't it equally weird that when us Christians get squeezed, everything but Jesus comes out of us? When the devil squeezed me, my first reaction was to throw a pity party. And I told everyone that my life was over, all because God was punishing me for the things that I've done. We prayed long and hard together, and I went and had the PET scan done. A few days later, the results were in, and I was in the waiting room for what seemed like hours. The doc came in with some papers in his hand, and he threw them at me across the room. And he said, "This is a hospital for cancer patients, and you're cancer-free. So please get out of my office." I instantly started crying, and I gave the doctor the biggest bear hug that I'm sure he'll never forget. And since then, I've had one other test done that came back negative as well. This past April, I celebrated 5 years cancer-free, all thanks to the blood of Jesus and the power of prayer.
Amen.
Instead of running away from her creepy, sick boyfriend, my beautiful wife decided to marry me, and it wasn't long after that that we discovered we were pregnant with Madison. This was a very exciting time for me, but I was still holding on to those demons that were alcohol and drugs. And you would think, after the cancer scare, that alcohol and drugs would be history. But they made the mistake of telling me that the cancer was not caused by drugs or alcohol, so I just figured that gave me free rein to continue doing what I was doing. All that came crashing down on me one day, the day after my daughter was born. She was born on a Friday, and this was a Saturday, and they were supposed to let us go home, but they found an issue at the base of Madison's spine that they wanted to keep us another day until Sunday to have it looked at. The big problem that I had was I remembered I was out of alcohol at the house, and they don't sell whiskey on Sunday. So Kristen sent me to a little cafe across the parking lot from the hospital to get us something to eat. And while I was out there, I thought to myself, sometime today I need to sneak away to the liquor store without her knowing and get some booze so I could celebrate the birth of my daughter when I got home. And it was at this point that I stopped in the middle of the parking lot and I dropped to my knees and I just said, "What are you doing, you idiot? You know, this is supposed to be the happiest time of your life and all you can think about is alcohol." So I prayed to God and I said, "Please take it all away. I'm done, I'm tired of it, and I want it to be finished. I can't do it by myself." You see, when you try to fight demons with your own strength and power, you get beat every time, no question. But when you have the proper tools and you give it to our Father, the creator of the universe, the demons, no matter how big they seem, they're done in the blink of an eye.
Amen.
From that day forward, I was drug-free, cigarette-free, alcohol-free. I never touched another one to this day forward, and I never had the desire to. It just proves that all things are possible with Christ. I tried to quit smoking for years. I tried the Nicorette gum. I couldn't keep it lit. I used the patch to get stuck on my tongue. I was a complete and total mess. But God stepped in. The Bible says that the enemy comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. But I have come to give you life and life more abundantly. That's not just in heaven. That's here right now on earth. Jesus didn't die on Calvary just to get us into heaven. He died on Calvary to get heaven into us here on earth, so we can start sharing the good news with other people that we come in contact with on a daily basis. So after the alcohol was gone, I decided to step out in faith and start Otten Brothers Taxidermy. We're coming on our fourth season, and God has doubled our workload every year, all because I gave the business to Him.
Yes.
Jesus Christ is my CEO today and for the rest of my life. Y'all know the story of David and Goliath? The entire Israelite army, along with Saul, they were gathered across the valley from the Philistine army. The opposing army had a giant warrior named Goliath. He was 9 feet tall. And the entire Israelite army was afraid of Goliath. But David, a young shepherd boy, the youngest of 8 kids, knew who God was, and he had no fear of anything. He killed the lion and the bear when no one was around but him and God. And every day, Goliath would come out onto the battlefield asking the Israelites to send their best to fight him. And he did this every day for over a month. No one in that army, including Saul, their leader, would go out to fight him. All but the little shepherd boy, David, armed with the proper tools, he picked up his sling, which I believe is God, and picked up a smooth stone, which I believe is Jesus Christ, the rock of our salvation. And while he was doing this, Goliath kept coming out and mocking him. But David knew that the battle was not his, it was the Lord's. So David charged Goliath, and he launched that rock into the wind, which I believe is the Holy Spirit wind. And that wind guided that rock deep into Goliath's forehead, and he killed him instantly. All this happened because of one fearless boy who knew his father. So what kind of demons are calling you guys out on the battlefield tonight? Mine were drugs and alcohol, along with many others. Anything that comes between us and our Creator God is a problem that needs to be dealt with. The Bible says that wide is the gate that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate, and narrow is the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. And I know all this sounds like a bummer, but it's not. There's hope for all of us. And that hope is at the foot of a blood-stained cross on Calvary. Amen. Jesus died for all of our sins, once for all. I told myself a lie many years that I had done so much wrong that God could never possibly forgive me. Let's take a walk up on Calvary Hill back on the night that Jesus was crucified. Jesus had been beaten half to death, and he was hanging on a cross between two thieves. And one of these thieves was mocking Jesus, telling him, "If you really are the king, then why don't you save yourself and save me while you're at it?" But the other guy, the thief on the other side, is where I find my hope. You see, back in the day, crucifixion was saved for the worst of the worst. These guys weren't criminals with misdemeanor charges. These were career, lifelong, felon, bad dudes. The thief on the other side knew who Jesus was, and he believed in him. And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus looked over at him, and he said, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Like I said, these were the worst of the worst. And Jesus said that you're going to be with me in heaven. James 2:10 says, "For whoever keeps the whole law, yet stumbles at just one point, is guilty of breaking it all." And there are 613 laws and 10 commandments in the Bible. And it says if we miss one, we miss them all. So basically that tells us that it's impossible to be perfect. Only Jesus was able to be without sin. So all of the junk and the funk that I've done in my life, everything that I went through, all the evil things that I did to other people, was all washed away by the blood dripping off the forehead and pouring out of the side of Jesus. Heaven went bankrupt when he sent his son down to die for our sins, and all he asked in return is that we believe in him. It's a pretty good deal, if you ask me. So call your demons out on the battlefield and expose them for what they are, nothing but lies from Satan, and then slay them with the power given to you by your Creator in heaven. If you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I pray that you don't wait another day. The biggest trick that Satan likes to play on people is that he convinces them that there's plenty of time to repent and to accept Christ later. Satan is a defeated foe because of what Jesus did on the cross, and the only thing that he can do is to try to drag as many people to hell with him as possible. The truth is, though, we have no idea when we will take our last breath. I thought mine was 35 years old. As long as we are on this side of the grave, there's still time to repent and to ask Christ into our lives. But once we die and we take our last breath here, we take our first breath either in heaven with our Creator or in hell with Satan and his fallen angels. Those cards that are on your table that Phil had you fill out, on the back side there's kind of a checklist back there. I'd just like to ask you guys to fill that out if you need prayer. You may want help with a certain sin that's giving you trouble, or you may want to finally take that step to accept Christ for the first time in your life. This church wants to come alongside you and help you with that, so please reach out to them. I love you guys. We are brothers and sisters in Christ, and I thank you so much for letting me pour my guts out to you. If I offended anyone, I'm truly sorry. It was not intentional. I was not properly vetted by the church before I came up here. They thought I was just talking about taxidermy, so all I ask is that you hold that against me, not them. I have business cards over here on the table. If you ever need any taxidermy work done, I'd be honored to take care of that for you. But more importantly, feel free to give me a shout anytime if you have any questions about my testimony or if you just want to chat about something that's on your mind. God bless you all, and thank you very much. Thank you.